Today I want to take the spotlight in the 3D environment in Fusion and see if I can get some accurate three-dimensional light rays out of that spotlight. So I want to have a glowing effect in the air that looks like it's really three-dimensional rays in the scene. I have done something similar last week where I used 2D post-processing effects to get these kind of volumetric lights, but now I actually want to do it in 3D. The advantage would be that I can have really a rotating camera movement around it and hopefully still get a very nice and accurate rays or nice light effects out of this. I'm not starting from scratch today. I have created myself a very simple 3D scene that looks like this. It's just a few blocks basically put together and added some textures on top of it. If you want to use it as well, you can just download this file from my website and use it to follow along. Or if you prefer, you can use any other scene. You just need to put a light somewhere. So whatever motion graphics or 3D scene you are working with should be fine. I am starting from this. You can do it in DaVinci Resolve or in Fusion Studio, whichever you prefer. The free version of Resolve is fine. And when you're ready, let's get started. If you're interested in the scene as well, just quickly for orientation. Basically, it's just a mixture of lots of shape 3Ds. Here I have a ground cube and then you have a few cubes on top and I have duplicated some of them. So these are all cubes and I have attached some default shaders which you can find in the shader library of the Fusion bins. So you find here these, this is perforated metal, I don't know, maybe I replace it later, I don't know. But these are some default shaders you can find which I just directly attached. And I think I should do a tutorial on materials as well. And I have planned it maybe in one of the next weeks. I think I will do more about materials, but otherwise even without materials, this is just a very simple geometry. And the roof is also a simple cube and I used a bender to make it a bit tilt. The speakers, if you're wondering, there I have a texture or a photograph basically. So I have this simple photograph here, which I'm putting on one, where is it? On one side of a cube and the other sides are just black. So one photo and that's already my speaker. So this way I have this stage and my logo is just text 3D. Of course, feel free to replace it. I want to start by building the spotlight with a physical light, like a casing. And for this, I can just use a cylinder or a cone. And then I want to put the light inside, maybe put a screen in front so that the physical object is itself in the scene and I can see the light in the scene. And then at the end, I think about the cone or the light rays that I want to come out. So first, I'm starting with the shape 3D here and I just use either a cylinder or a cone. I think I use a cone because the cone you can open here and give it a little bit of an angle. So I'm making something like this here. So just with a slight angle, something that slightly opens. I will close it at the bottom so that, you know, this is my final casing for the light. Probably I want to have it a bit smoother, you know, by default the subdivisions are not very good. So if I increase them, I get a smoother shape. Then I will put a separate object as the screen so I can control that separately. And as the screen, I will just put a cylinder. I could use a plane or so, but it's rectangular, so I have to mask it out or something. You can do that. I do it easier and I just add another shape 3D here. And by default, it already gets merged because I had it selected, which is fine because I want to merge them anyways separately here. So I build everything separately and at the end I place it into the scene. So let me use a cylinder here and this cylinder, let me bring this into the view, the merge into the view. And the cylinder is in the middle. I can now make it very thin. I don't know, 0.1 or something or 0.5. Let's see how it looks. It can maybe give us a slight fringe at the top, give a little bit of detail. That's fine. The cylinder also needs a bottom or a top. I think I just go for a bottom, but only one, not both, because otherwise what I want to do is I want to light it from one side and want to make sure that I can see the light there. If you make two planes, only one of them will be lit. But if I have only one plane, like only the bottom or only the top, then this will be lit from underneath. So this cylinder, also a few more subdivisions to make it round. And I can think about here you are 0.9 something, so it's almost at the top, a bit lower. And the radius, I can make it a bit bigger to just fit in here. Okay, so now it fits in. Let's think about the color. This one here is white, and I will leave it white. It will be the white screen for my lights. And the casing outside, which is this cylinder, this I will just color black. Okay, now I have a white casing, a white screen on top of a black cylinder. And I can place the light into this. So let's keep the geometry on the side. And then let me bring in a spotlight into this merge. And it's already in the center, which is nice. Let me now turn it around. It needs to point upwards, I guess. So I turn it around the x-axis and bring it up. Sorry, wrong selection. Spotlight. Let me turn it up here. So now it's pointing upwards. Let me make that exact, and it should probably be 90 degrees. And here you see what's happening. So lights are enabled in the scene, and the spotlight is illuminating a small part of this cylinder. If I bring it down, I can bring it down here to the back, then it's illuminating a bigger one. And if I want, I can also control here the intensity, angle, and so on. We will probably do this more once it's in there, but you can already see a bit the effect, so maybe something like this should be good, with some drop off to the side and some hot center kind of in the middle. Okay, now this is my light. Oh, I see a little bit of a spot here, so the light is slightly below the cylinder, so let me bring it slightly above. So now the light is inside this cone. Okay, so that's it for the geometrical object. Let me now place it into the scene. Let me bring this up a little bit. And I put a Transform 3D here. Transform 3D. The reason I use the Transform is I like to keep these things a bit separated from the merges, especially in 3D, so you can easily see where you actually manipulate the geometry and where you just add lots of different things together. And Transform has a translation, rotation, and pivot, and I will put a pivot to the place where I think this would be mounted, this light, and this way I can use it easier for rotation. So if I bring the pivot, this is the y direction, if I bring the pivot down, then if I rotate now around x, you see here on the right side, I'm rotating around the point where it would actually be mounted to the stage. Of course, the size and so on, I can already turn it a bit, but the size is wrong. I definitely need to make it much smaller, maybe like this. And then, of course, the position also. Let's place it into the scene here at the end. So I'll bring it up like this and then push it back to the end. And if you wanted to, you could actually check the coordinates of these beams and could do it precisely, but I think just by eye should be good enough. Okay, now where is the light? I don't see any light in the scene. I see the white top, but I don't see light. Let's check the merges. So often merges may be the reason. Yes, here pass through lights is disabled. So that means we have light only in this merge, but the light in this merge is not passing onwards. So I need to enable this. If I enable it, then I should get light in the next scene. Go one more step. Let's go to this scene, because here I have the ambient light, which I can now decrease. And I think I don't have lights at all. So let me turn on lights and shadows. So that's it. Now I have lights and shadows enabled here. And you can see now the cone on the floor. All right. Let's think about the intensity here. So the spotlight has no decay at the moment. Let me turn on some decay. This way I should get a very bright spot on the top here and less towards the bottom, but I can change this with the decay rate. And if I bring this down, I still have a very bright white here and where it's hitting the logo, and less here. So I think that's a good start. So I think this is okay for my light. Now I have one light. Maybe I want more than one, and that's very easy. I can just duplicate it. So let me add a duplicate 3D here. Duplicate 3D. Add. And maybe I bring one more transform before the duplicate so that I can push it to the side and then move it all the way. I could also do it with this, actually. Okay, let's keep it with this. So I just move in this transform. I'll just move it to the side somewhere here, and with the duplicate I'm making a few copies. How many? I don't know. How many lights do we want? Let's say 5, and then I can spread them out with the X offset and spread them over the scene. So now I have 5 lights over the scene, and I have duplicated the whole thing, including the lights and everything. So all lights and shadows and everything just gets spread out quickly via this. All right, so now we have the lights and they nicely shine on top of the logo, which I think I like. And of course I can still adjust it. So if I want my transform here, just some angle adjustment now works on all the lights at the same time, which I think is very nice. If you want, you could also animate it, right? You know, maybe light up in the beginning or something like this, have some moving lights. That would be fun, maybe. Also, you can, of course, animate the intensity. But before I think about any animations or anything funny, let's just bring the rays into the scene, which is actually the topic of this tutorial. So for this, I just want to put some cone and then animate the transparency and see that it interacts correctly with the light. Let's bring in another cone shape I can start from this scene where I have my light here. And I bring another shape 3D into the scene. Maybe I put it under the light here because it's somehow related to the actual spotlight rather than the geometry of the light. And I use a cone, which I don't see right now. But okay, let's have a look at this cone itself. So first of all, we probably have to turn it around. And second of all, I will again put a pivot point up so that I can scale it in one direction only. So I want the cone to come out of the light only in one direction, and I want to control this. So it's always good to have the pivot point in a good place for that. And here I can just bring the pivot point up to the top, which is at 1, I guess. And now if I rotate and you see on the left what's happening, okay. So now I have actually the light rotating 180 degrees exactly. I have this kind of funny cone coming out of the light. Of course, that's not the final solution, but just to see, let's scale it up a bit. And I should look again at the final scene, how this looks like. Okay, so now I have some ugly cones coming out, but it's good enough to see the directions. And maybe just, you know, for getting the cones right, I can disable the duplicate for now. If I just disable it, I can deal with one at a time and later enable it again. So let's increase this even more. 5 is obviously not enough. Let's bring it to 10. Okay, or even more than that, 15. Okay, so now this cone hits the entire stage and more. More I don't care about, so or maybe I do, we'll find out at the end, but for now I'll just want it to go everywhere. And it gets dark, it's very bright here and very dark here, so maybe the light doesn't actually hit all of it, and also this shape here obviously doesn't look good. So let's see if I can fix this with the cone settings. So let me increase the top radius a bit so that it, yeah. And then so that I get something more round here. And then let's decrease the radius here and see if this works okay to some degree. All right, let's, what else can we do? I see some highlights here, which is not good. So let me disable the specularity. So these are specular highlights, so these super shiny reflections. So these I will completely disable, intensity zero. Then, of course, we don't want this solid, but we want this transparent. And there are actually two types of transparency here. One is the alpha channel and one is the opacity. Now, why is that? One, opacity means the opacity of the whole object independent of any textures. And alpha channel regulates the transparency of the particular of the diffuse channel here. So if you have, for example, if you have diffuse and specularity, the alpha channel of the diffuse controls only this. The opacity controls the whole opacity of the object. So for here now it will look pretty similar, but I will go for the alpha. I think you can use both. And if I make it completely transparent, then it's gone. But as soon as there's something, then you see a transparent white light. And of course you need some diffuse color here in order to capture the light that is shining. So if I have transparency zero, there's no diffuse color. That also means that there's nothing the light is actually shining on. So I definitely need some, but I don't want it to look solid. So I do something in between. And the second part is I want to be able to animate the light at the end. Let's see how this looks like if I animate the intensity. So you see it goes to black. Now the light on top going to black, that's maybe okay. So if it's really completely black and no other light in the scene, which is maybe also not entirely correct, but we can fix this. But especially this cone here should not go to black, it should instead vanish, right? So what I will do is I will use the second slider here, the opacity, and will actually link it to the intensity of the light. So let me select both of these tools at the same time. So I will go into the shape tool while both tools are selected, and in the shape tool I will link the opacity. And here I can put an equal sign, which opens the expression for me. And then with the plus sign, I drag it onto the spotlight and here onto the intensity from the spotlight. So what do I have now? I have an expression here. And if I go into the spotlight and I animate the intensity, sorry, that's the wrong intensity. Where is my spotlight? Here, this intensity. This is from the spotlight. You see that the light actually goes completely off. So when it's off, there's no opacity at all. And then it increases. And at one, the opacity is completely there, but the alpha channel is still only 50%. So it still shines through. Okay, this cone is still a bit too rough. So let's go into the shape here, into the geometry settings, and bring the subdivisions up to make it soft. And then I think we are already somewhere on a good track. Let's enable them all via the duplicate. And there is an issue, and you see that the cones are shining onto each other. So basically this spotlight is shining onto this cone from the other one. But besides this, I think it's starting to look interesting. Okay, let's improve this further. First step, I definitely need to separate these cones. And one trick for this is to use a merge node, which has this pass-through setting disabled. That's what you saw earlier. If I put a merge in here, and is this the cone? Yeah, this is the cone. And I have now, if I put the light into this and disable it for here for now, just to separate, then you see now we have the light shining only on one cone, but not onto each other. Now I'm not lighting up the scene. I'm currently only putting the light into this merge here. But what I can do is, I still need to light the scene, of course, so I need to have it here. What I can do is I can put it in both places, and now I build a parallel scene here and make sure that this is coming into the main scene, kind of downstream of the lights themselves. So what I mean is I kind of need to connect it here, but with the right transformations. And I have only two transformations here. I have the duplicate and the transform, which determine the position. So I copy those and I duplicate and transform these cones separately. And then I can attach them separately into the scene, and I can attach them into the scene after the lights that are illuminating the whole scene. So this way I can make sure these cones are not lit from the same lights that light the whole scene, but have their own dedicated lights. So let's do this. So here I have the duplicate and the transform. I copy and paste both. If you want, you can make an instant paste, Control-Shift-V, which links all the parameters. That's always nice to see that, you know, we are doing something parallel here. We are doing the same here. I bring the merge in here from these cones, and I attach this now into a merge behind. So I attach it into this merge maybe. And the ambient light, I don't know if I even need it, but I bring it back into the front so it's not affecting this. So now we have until here, and let me see if I have my spotlight. Until here I have the scene, until this merge, I have the scene completely lit the way I want it with the spotlights and the ambient light. And then here I have only the cones, which are still lit from the spotlight, but because this is the pass-through is disabled, the spotlights here don't interact with each other. So I'm only lighting up one cone, and then the lights don't have no effect downwards, but the lit up object is being duplicated and transformed and then merged into the scene. And that means I now have them here, and I made some more mistake somewhere here. This one shouldn't have pass-through lights. This merge here accidentally had the pass-through lights, which is not necessary because I have the whole scene coming before, and all my lights for the scene are coming in here, and after this I only have the cones here. Okay, so this was the trick to separate the lights from the scenes. That is something you can do frequently. Sometimes you want to light something only from the back and want something glowing, but you don't want the rest of the scene affected, and these kind of things happen. So it's very good that with the merge tools you have this kind of control. Let's go one step further. I will do a little bit more of fine-tuning here. So I think the main effect is there, but what we can do is we can make this a bit less defined and bring a bit of noise in here. So I have my here I have my cylinder. So if you want, you can attach some noise. So let's bring in a fast noise, which is the go-to noise tool for all circumstances, and I will just attach it to the shape of the cylinder. And if I do this, the noise gets mapped onto this cylinder. Now there's one edge which is not very clean, but that may not even be a big deal. But the fast noise, I can change the scale, and you see how it affects the cylinder itself. So maybe give it a bit of noise. You can usually scale and detail are the two main sliders here. Of course, you can make it brighter, less bright, and so on, but we can control this also in other places. But scale and detail decide how smooth or rough it is and how small or large the patterns are of the noise. So this is maybe okay. Another thing is, at the moment, these cones go all the way down and actually even further. So perhaps we want to mask it a bit and have it more intense at the top and then fade out a bit. It's kind of doing that already because of the intensity of the spotlight. So the spotlight is hitting more, or the, you know, is there's a larger part of the spotlight cone that is hitting this shape 3D cone. So that's why it's a bit brighter here than further down. But we can control this even further if we mask the noise a bit. So the noise is now the texture on top of this shape, And if I put a mask here, then this mask is controlling this shape, controlling the texture here. And we have to, I can check how this mask is being affected. So this way, if I bring it from here, you see only part of the cone is coming. This is the lower part. I'll just try a bit and see from where. So if I bring a mask from the top, you see that I'm kind of bringing in more. So let's bring this, let's make this full screen. So this is the full cone, right? And then if I bring this up, I see that it's being chopped off from the top. So this way, this texture relates to the cone. So I still have the full cone, the texture goes all around, but I can decrease it and then I can give it a soft edge. And this way it kind of fades out towards the end. And this is what I wanted. Okay, I think that's enough on the 3D part of the cone. Yes, I can do more, but instead I want to do one more trick on the post-processing. And if you look at them, they're still, even with the noise pattern and so on, they're not looking very soft, right? You still have hard lines here if I look in the renderer. And what I want to do is I want some glow or blur at the end, right? And this is something that is almost impossible to do in 3D, but fairly easy in 2D. So at the end, I want probably something like a glow or soft glow or blur. Let me add a soft glow maybe. Soft glow is a nice tool for lights. And you see the kind of effect it's doing. And I want something like this on these lights, but I don't want it on the whole scene, right? So here I have it on the whole scene, which looks terrible, but I want it only on the lights. And maybe some additional blur and other things. So whatever I want to do now, I need to have a way to select only the lights. There are two ways of doing this. One way would be to render the lights separately, or these light cones. So I could detach them from my main renderer, copy the renderer, and then attach the camera. So build kind of two parallel scenes, one for the lights, and then merge them again in 2D at the end. There's another trick that I want to use today. I can build a mask based on object or material properties in the scene. And that's the way I want to go now. I show you what I mean. I go here into the shape 3D from these cones. And if you look in the material properties, you see down here a material ID. And this is now set to 20. And it's set, it should be set differently for every material. So Fusion puts something in there by default, but you can change it as well. And what is happening now, if I want to, I can go into the renderer and I can, in the output channels, enable the material ID as an additional output channel. And this is now an additional channel from my renderer, which has in each pixel of the image the material ID as a value. So this is a technical channel, right? So in addition to RGB and alpha, my renderer now also renders the material ID. How can I use this? I need to somehow create an alpha channel now based on the material ID that I'm interested in. And I can do a little bit of channel logic here. If I bring in a channel boolean, then I can first of all bring the material ID into the alpha channel. So in the channel boolean, I can copy channels here. I have the alpha channel by default, but now I want to bring in the material ID foreground to alpha. So this takes the material ID, and I don't have a foreground, so it takes from the background and copies this material ID into the alpha channel. So now I have my material ID in the alpha channel. The only problem is you won't see anything useful here because of the range. If I now go over here, you see in the bottom the alpha channel here has value 20. And if I go somewhere else, it has value 18. And here it has value 7. So this is outside of the range of typical masks, but I can restrict it via color grading or with a bitmap tool, or there are different ways. Let me bring in a brightness and contrast from here, connect it, and I bring it into the second viewer. I already have, I want to look at the alpha channel here, And I only want to manipulate the alpha channel. Alpha is disabled by default. So this way brightness and contrast only works on the alpha channel. And I bring now the high value up, and I need to bring it up to 20, which was the number of my material ID. So I want to have the white point of my color correction to 20. So 20 is now remapped to 1 white. So white value of should be 20. So it's brightness and contrast. It is bringing now the value which was 20, bringing it down to 1 for the white point. And the black point I can bring up to exclude other stuff, and you see what happens. So different materials have different IDs, and if I bring the low point up, they are vanishing here, right? So I can bring it all the way up to 20 or 19, and then I have a mask which selects only this material. Now I can attach this to my soft glow and bring in the color channel again, and voila, I have a glow which works hopefully only on this, but I don't want the alpha channel. The soft glow actually has two mask inputs. The default mask input just hard masks off the effect of the soft glow. This is the default way a mask input works, but it has a second mask input which masks off the area from which the glow should be calculated. So if I attach this to the second mask input here, and for some reason this is not working. Ah, okay, probably because I have a whole image here and not something that is being recognized as a mask. If that happens, just add a bitmap tool to the end. Bitmap, and this tool transforms an image into a mask. It just tells Fusion that you have a mask here before it recognized this as a whole RGB image, and the mask input was fine with it, interestingly, but the second mask input didn't accept it. And with the bitmap tool, you just tell, okay, this is just the alpha channel, this is only a mask, and this way it was actually recognized. Actually, we could have done the color correction in the bitmap tool, but that's fine, it's the same effect. So now I have the mask attached to the soft glow mask, and this is telling glow only whatever is masked in there, but the glow itself can go beyond the boundary of the mask. So the glow is going on top nicely, it's glowing to the sides, and only the area is glowing which is coming from this original cone here. Okay, and this is my result so far. I think that's it for the tutorial. So I really have transformed some solid cone into something that looks a bit glowing and has a bit of a pattern and so on. Now for the overall look, of course, there's more that I can do. I can maybe do some better textures, define the cones more, you know, play with the noise pattern, do more post-processing. In 2D, you know, this glow is maybe just a bit too rough here. Of course, there are things to do. And I might do a little bit on my own now. Feel free to have a look at it. I will upload this version, and I will also upload a final, a bit more, slightly more fine-tuned version. But from the techniques that I wanted to use, I have covered them. So I leave it at this. I hope you liked it. Let me know what you want to see next. Maybe something about materials. I'm thinking about it to do a bit more in that direction. Let's see. So my name is Bernd. Thanks for watching. See you next week. Thank you.